it's my pleasure to welcome James to speak to us. Thank you for coming in to speak to us. James studied architecture at Plymouth and at Bartlett as well, before he established Studio Octopi in 2003. He's also the co-founder of the Thames Baths Project, which is interesting about. And he's also a lecturer at Teachers as well. So it's my pleasure to welcome him for this lecture.
Of a courtyard house in Wiltshire to the audience of an open air theatre in Berkshire, finishing off with an urban swim in the Thames. And the space outside of the buildings, as much as inside of the buildings, is also what we're kind of interested in. So, just looking at brief other projects which we're in Studio Octopi are doing. So, we've top left is an arts foundation. Small. The one at the bottom is celebrating 50 years of graphics at the RCA. So we designed a series of exhibition furniture in a way to help display the posters from the last years. Top right is a residential project, again sort of based in London. A lot of the 50% of our work is probably private residential. And at the bottom right is a this goes into a boardroom for a advertising agency. Done about five laptops in the course of years. They're a real, almost sort of the opposite to things like the private house, which take years to do. So we're currently doing 40,000 square foot office fit out, and that's going to go from start to completion in 6 months. So as opposed to a private house, which can take kind of 5 years, suddenly you get to see things very quickly. So back to tonight's landscape and stage. First project is a new build house in Wiltshire. This was with a client who came to us first when she was living in London. And it was actually came to us through the Yellow Pages, which is about the only client I think who's come to us through the Yellow Pages. But she had a change of lifestyle, moved out of London, and for a number of years, we worked with her about plots of which were all about in the countryside. There were these plots which looked out onto green fields, and it didn't go anywhere. And then in July 2007, she actually purchased a greenfield site, so 190 square metres, in a small town in Carnham, Wiltshire. And it was at the rear of the town's historic centre, which was the old green. So the house which we've actually superimposed the in the sort of bottom or mid left hand side, you might see just a sort of green rectangle, a couple of green rectangles. At the top of the image is the old green of the town, and then the row of buildings which go along left to right are all Grade One listed buildings. And the access to the site is down through the listed buildings on a track and kind of comes around the back. And the land was actually partitioned off from the green sort of next to it, which was basically private gardens to do with the houses on the green. And the client came to us very much concerned about a number of factors. She is in a wheelchair, so she was concerned about the aesthetics of a house and didn't want to be seen to be sort of living in a bungalow. But she also wanted a protective house in terms of being very safe within their environment. So when we started the project, we were interested in both surroundings. But also then we were interested in this idea of courtyard house and how the courtyard house and the typology of the courtyard house might give the client the sort of protective nature that she required. We also then looked at walled gardens and this idea of the secret behind the walled garden, this idea of views through space beyond. So the initial sketches that we developed with the client formed around a series of enclosures, creating a private internal space. So the lower one is a plan, the idea that a house formed around a series of courtyards, and the top is a section. Very indicative at this stage, we're trying to kind of agree with the client on way forward. So how does that translate into reality? Well, this is the a view of the building as seen from the entrance of the track. And it started to give you this sense of enclosure. So actually that boundary wall, which you can see, which is a reinstatement, the previous owners had been a little bit tricky, shall we say. They managed to knock down a listed wall without planners realizing it. So when our client came to, when we came to negotiate with the planners, they wanted to know where the wall had gone. And so one of these sort of bizarre conversations take place, and the plans wanted the wall reinstated. They didn't really care what the wall was made of, so we could have actually had a blockwork wall go back up, but the wall had to be reinstated. And these are some of the sort of just like nuances you get when you start negotiating with the planners. In the planning application, we actually had this term, which was reconstituted stone, basically meaning concrete. In the end, the client decided that they wanted to keep it more sort of within the sort of local surroundings, so we actually built it out of reclaimed stone from the local area. But we also wanted to have a twist on that, so actually what we did is we put a concrete core in the middle and then built up this wall. So it's over 3 meters high, but it's only sort of 4 feet deep. So again, it's sort of twisting the sort of the nature of what would be a standard dry stone wall. So the house was developed around a series of courtyards. So the track and entrance is coming in on the right-hand side. The old boundary wall kind of obliquely against the grid. And then the house is formed as this L-shaped or part U-shaped. So you have the entrance courtyard at the bottom, a small inner courtyard where the tree is, with a rear courtyard at the back. And at the back was facing a listed building. And so we were restricted in height by, we couldn't go any higher than the barn or the back. And if you just see at the right hand side, you can just about pick out the roof of the listed barn. And with that came the restriction in height, but the client was adamant, even though she had a very limited budget and it would have been easier to go for a single story house, she was adamant that we had to have two stories. She didn't want this house to be read as a bungalow, which she synonymous with eventually someone in a wheelchair, they don't have a second story. So she was adamant, even though she was in a wheelchair and limited budget, she wanted to have this second story. So there was interesting conversations with her about sort of the perceptions of people that are in a wheelchair and the perceptions of someone who is doing their own house in a wheelchair and what they should have. So we went to the expense of actually putting in a lift for her, just so she could access this very small area at second floor level. So this was the second floor. The windows in this were very restricted because we are high up, and too with sort of covenants to do with how the land was sold, you couldn't look out over to people's gardens. So we had to direct views into her own space, and again, sort of trying to set all the windows at the right height so somebody in a wheelchair could actually look out of the windows rather than somebody standing up. So a lot of the windows, the sill level, if you're standing up, is actually very low, and the head height feels incredibly low. But they were all designed around her ability to sort of have the best view from the wheelchair. So this is the entrance into the property. So this is through from the boundary wall. And the materials that we chose were partly taken from an agricultural aesthetic. So we had galvanized steel. The renders were all, there's a lime render, which was kept in its natural state. All the timber was just very lightly white oiled, so it would go keep and kind materials which we wanted to do, partly because of a budget, but also partly because they regarded it as sort of sat against all these other things which were going on up around the site, which was very busy. So looking back towards the entrance, these were taken just before all the external works were finished, and so the gate is actually missing, but you can kind of see throughout into the track. The front door is the one on the left, and then this formed a frameless glass enclosure, which basically was a tree that was going to be planted in the middle. The tree's lacking a little bit in leaves at the moment and sort of size, but that was part of getting that grow to be solar shading because it's facing the south. But what that does is it creates a sort of inner courtyard, which is also part of the house. So the sections, you can just start to see the idea of what size the tree should be in terms of its shading. And this is from the inside. So this inner courtyard is supposed to be really part of the house. And again, for the client, it was very much this inner courtyard wanted to be very protective. So again, sort of the overlooking was reduced as much as possible. Internally, the materials were kept very simple. So we're choosing ceramic tiles for the floor, very simple stone for the fireplaces. And the ability was able to, behind the wardrobe on the left, or some storage back on the left, and there's a sliding door to the right. So she can kind of close the space down as well, so she can kind of feel less like she's in a sort of fishbowl, and she can kind of close it down to make the space feel more homely. Just take it through around the house. This is in her bedroom, so again, so you have these views back out into this inner courtyard, which were quite key. She was also keen, she had loads of books, and so this was partly her bookshelf. And so again, we designed it so it's wide enough to be able to sit and look out over the courtyard. So it's trying to sort of mirror the two insides and outsides of this. This is then the main living space. And one of the, again, sort of the key things in talking through with the client is that actually she didn't, although she had a very limited budget, she wanted to sort of maximise what she can in terms of space. So this was a double high space with a gallery kind of walkway connecting the two upper levels, and at the top is then this roof line, which just makes the space feel, generally it's much bigger because it's obviously double height. But you also at night then we had the lighting coming from above as well, so you mimic the sort of daylighting in the evening. At the back it changes its sort of its properties really again, and this is where you get the sort of two-story element facing onto the sheltered courtyard. The barn is the other side of this. So this was a sort of real protective courtyard with a wall on one side. But again, quite simply, sort of keeping the each of the rooms had their own access onto the space. So there's on the right-hand side is a studio, on the left-hand side the kitchen. But framing it is this view, which you get all the way down through, all the way through all the courtyard back to the front of the house. The other aspect of the house, which I haven't really touched on, but again, she wanted to make it as environmentally friendly, I suppose, as she could within her budget. This was where the COVID disabled homes was unlimited peak, if you like. And for us as a firmologist and for the client, one of the frustrations became is that actually it becomes COVID disabled homes becomes a tick boxing exercise. And so, whilst the house was designed to code level 5 from energy perspective, we could only reach code level 4 because the sort of tick boxing exercises one has to go through, you know, to try and find a builder that can deal with a waste management plan when you've only got 300,000 to spend. It's just like the builder's looking at you going, waste management plan, but you know, what's one of those? I take my rubble out and I give it to the farmer and he spreads it over the field. It's like, yes, but have you got, you know, can you fill in a form which says all of that? And he's like, quite frankly, no. She had to put in a drying rack and a drying line, even though she can't actually reach the drying line, purely to get a point on the system. So these are sort of the sort of little battles one faces. In the end, the client got really So moving from one dusk to another, this is Bradfield College Greek Theatre. So again, another project which had a rather long gestation period. My business partner used to go to school many years ago, and whilst you might think that that would be an entrance into the school, actually, it enabled us to speak to the bursar. But the bursar was very wary of, he thought we were just going to come along and charge him lots of fees. And they were, they had their fingers burnt, I think, previously. So we worked with the school over a course of, I think it was about 2 years. This is a shot taken, this is maybe artwork at the end of the theatre. And previous to this, it had been in a derelict state, and they had a number of architects look at it, all coming back really expensive. And the history of the project, I think, was set up against us. But in the end, we managed to convince them to kind of go with us. But it's that sort of process of working with a client over a period of time to actually, and looking at their side of the breach. So their biggest thing was access. So it wasn't a grand project when we started looking at this, but it's how you kind of generate a project from something which at the first start just seems like it's kind of more about the landscape than anything else. So the history. So the, Bradfield is a private school, and it's actually a village in its own right. So this actually encompasses most of the school itself, so just outside Reading. And the Greek Theatre is actually almost in the centre of the shot. You can just sort of make out a space of like pale yellow in the centre. So how did you get to have an outdoor Greek Theatre in Berkshire? Well, the headmaster back in the 1800s decided that he wanted to change the gravel pit into a version of Epidaurus, which is a outdoor Greek Theatre. One of the most famous ones built in about the 4th century. So this was his version of it, and it was built to apparently save the school from bankruptcy, and they now put on plays in Greek every 3 years. The students have no formal training, and they learn their lines whilst they are studying for all their other curriculum. The plays stopped in 2003 when it was deemed that access into the theatre and the theatre building itself, which was this rather grand theatre, Greek sort of temple and back, were condemned. So when we took over the project in 2012, we commissioned a movie, and I'm just going to play the movie, which gives you a sense of where it was at when we took it over. So it just shows how quickly, I mean, this was in the space of about 18 months. The theatre had gone from being used to becoming moss covered. And it was this wonderful wooded glade, really, with this sort of sky as an octopus over the top. And it was amazing. We'd actually been there, let's say, 18 months before, and it's still been, the concrete had sort of slightly rougher state, but the concrete had still been, you could steal concrete. 18 months later, it's amazing how quickly the vegetation had started to come back, moss had come over the steps. It really had this sort of feeling of an abandoned, almost sort of post-war industrial site. Part of the problem, as I said, was access. So you had really steep stairs and steps coming down into the theatre. And Chris used to tell stories about his grand coming down, sort of teaching down these steps in high heels, because they all come dressed up for an evening event. We're wondering whether sort of, you know, the officer was going to actually make it down the steps or not. So this was our setting, this was our site, this was what we had to work with. And you compare that to the original headmaster. master's vision. And one of the first things that we had to look at was doing our research about what and sort of the comparisons between Edinburghers and Bradford. Sadly, apart from them being outdoor theatres, this is a section to the side. There aren't really many. The rate of the Bradford theatre was such that actually the sight lines don't really work. The acoustics were terrible. We had a theatre consultant we were working with at the time, and they were pretty much like, this is really bad. If you want an outdoor theatre here, you know, it just doesn't, you know, if you're a theatre consultant, it doesn't work. You know, the school was saying, well, we put on plays every 3 years since 1890, so something works, if not quite at the same scale as Edinburgh. So getting that out of the way first was one of the So what did we do? Well, these basically highlight our sort of main moves. So at the top, we introduced a new meeting place. We introduced this new walkway around the back of the theatre. And we reformed the orchestra, which is the central disc, and the scheme, which is the building at the back of the theatre. So how did we go about doing it? Well, we did went with some links back to Greece. So we were interested in the idea of an agora, about a meeting place. And in Greece, this really was the center of, its literal meaning is a gathering place or assembly. And this is what we wanted to reintroduce. So in the northern part of the site, we scooped out an area between the trees and reintroduced this area of paving, which was a path around the back of the site, which basically brought in people to access, so you kind of really get this sort of meeting point. But then we wanted to take it one step further. So we took our inspiration from, this is a Philip Astley's amphitheatre in 1808, which was built on Westminster Bridge Road. And what we loved was these cantilevering balconies, really sort of taking you into the actual theatre. So we extended the agora out over the theatre. This is a 6 metre cantilever in places. And it gave the people a real chance both to meet, but also to sort of peer over, and it's another sort of point of the theatre. But they actually become part of the theatre themselves. So this is taken from below, and the kids love sort of just standing on the top. It's also incorporating the landscape, so we kept the more significant tree, and that comes straight. During performances, it also gives you a great place to see a different vantage point to see the performances. So the second point was, how do you create a grand entrance? Looking back at the Victorian entrances to the sort of grand theatres of the brass handrails and red velvet stairways, we weren't quite going to go to that extent, but what we did to do is then reintroduce a new staircase. This is on the tangential axis to the actual orchestra, and it starts off with two almost 2 metre wide staircases which combine at a central little platform before going down and meeting this new walkway which goes around the back of the theatre. And this gives us a real vantage point for people to sort of access the theatre, where before people were sort of tottering down steps from different locations. Now everyone comes through the same location, and they get this real sense of arrival. And the beauty about it is, whilst you can also have the people arriving, get a great view down to the theatre, people actually already in the theatre look back and see people arriving, so you get this real talking point between the two. And then as you get to the bottom, you start to sort of realise actually where you were, because when you're above the cantilever, you don't really get the sort of sense of the full scale of it. And as you come past it, you really get a sense of the the agora and the sort of meeting place above you. It also becomes aware of the sort of materiality of the project, and we were quite keen for it not to become too almost too twee. Actually, this was a real around software is that the idea is that in doing the galvanized mesh panels, is that over time the planting will be allowed to climb back over the mesh and retake back some of the actual landscape, so that it sort of once again goes back to being this sort of wooded plate. At night, we've introduced LED lighting at low level, and you get this band there which goes all the way around the walkway and under the stairs, which really give you this, again, different sense of theatre when they're leaving their performances. So the third aspect was a walkway, and this was kind of really the sort of the key bit that unlocked the whole project, because previously there'd been real bottlenecks. You kind of, everyone came down basically two stairs, they were very tight, it fed them into sort of into the amphitheatre, and then there were very limited areas about where they could go from there, and it created bottlenecks. Given that this seats 1,000 people, it just used to be a nightmare for people both kind of entering it and then also leaving it. And we used these two images to try and convince the client that, again, the walkway should be more than just a utilitarian aspect. But actually, there was something about the sense of arrival and the sense of theatre within the movement around the theatre, around the amphitheatre. So, what we introduced is this concrete walkway, which was recast in a black with a black aggregate in it, all the way around the back. And then linking off that with these galvanised steps that link down to a sort of middle walkway, if you like, which then allowed people to then sort of filter down through into the theatre. So this gave us sort of almost like a sort of grand sort of stand to the back of the theatre and ties it all together. It goes 270 degrees almost sort of around the whole of the theatre. Incorporated that, we had what we called leaning plates, and the balustrading, which is that a little bit higher, so it allowed people just to pause and again sort of play this game between people. So actually, there's been theatre looking over into the amphitheatre and being sort of looked at as well back from the stage. We also had to incorporate a new control hut, which again was kept in the same materials, and it was also cantilevered out from the walkway to give this sense of a theatre and continue the sort of dialogue between this and then the agora kind of even higher up. It has this huge, it's about 4.5 metres wide opening, trying to again bring some of the facilities of the modern theatre into the Greek theatre. So this is where all the control and lighting is done from. But you get this great view out, then back towards the scheme. And this was probably one of the more contentious parts of the project, really, is to make it do with the scheme. And for us, we were trying not to go back to replicate a Greek temple. And as this has now been demolished for about 3 or 4 years, I think, at this stage, what was amazing is when we actually put on the drawings the scale of the original building, no one actually believed us. No one actually thought the building was that big. And so when we proposed this building, they were going, you can't do something that big, or sort of, you know, it's too big for the site. So it was amazing that people's perception of what was there versus what we kind of wanted to put back after they'd had it taken away. It was completely different. So we went back and looked at Evdavros more from a point of view of saying, okay, what does the Greek play require in terms of theatrical stage? And there are key elements to it in terms of the loggia at the front and also the high-level windows, which are used as various theatrical devices depending on which plays up the top. So again, we did more research. We were working with a theatre consultant at the time as well. How can we translate this through into a more modern contemporary design? So this is what we ended up with. So it's a building with very simple timber framed building, which is flexible on multiple levels, really, because not only does it have to work for a Greek play, but it has to work for Shakespeare, it has to work for the school's commemorating day, which is when the whole school gathers in the amphitheatre. So it has to do with So at the bottom of the low level, we have almost a revision of the budget, which is the, where the doors can slide back completely open. It gives a recess for an orchestra to play in. It also gives the access through to a central doorway, which is used. And then at the high level, there's a series of openable doors, which allow performances to then sort of take place. It was also designed to actually, that they could fix scenery to the front of it, so there are metal struts which go through the structure to allow them to create this sort of screen in front. It's just a quick drawing showing the arrangement. And this is just then sort of looking at the structure, because again, due to the budget, we wanted to keep it as simple as possible. But then also that meant we had to, all of that structure was going to be on display, so we wanted to make sure that the structure all worked to its maximum capacity, and there's an elegance and simplicity to each of the elements of the structure. The difficult part was then convincing the contractor when he was building this that actually he couldn't just sort of throw it up and sort of cut it all internally and hide it. So we actually made this is a 1:20 structural model as we're viewing all of the structure, so we made everything kind of to the engineers and our sketches, and then also looking at the cladding on the outside, which is done in shingles, and the sort of slatting to the timber doors, and how they would stack up and how it worked, when it's going to work fully open and when it worked closed. So this is a shot internally. It's divided up into two changing rooms. But also the furniture was designed in a way which actually it could be moved, and so they wanted to use the rear of the area as a practice that they could do as well. So this is the theatre closing up. So the final project, this is the Thames Bath project. So this is where I come with two hats. You now have a CIC, which is a community interest company, which has been set up to look at reinstating swimming in the Thames. So this project's now been going on since 2013, and it started actually with a tweet. So I have to say, I'm not the person who does social media in the office, it's Chris, the other director. But he was on holiday in Zurich, swimming in these lovely basins which they are floating in the lake. And he received a tweet from the Architectural Foundation, which is in collaboration with the Royal Academy and Rogers Palmer, who were running their exhibition at the Royal Academy in celebration of Richard Rogers' 80th birthday. And it was to look at what London could be now, which was a twist on Richard Rogers' 1986 exhibition, which was London as it could be. So Chris had this wild idea that if the Swiss can do it, why can't we? They have these sort of floating pontoons, if you like, which are basically a series of them around Lake Zurich, which have varying depths and cater for different, I suppose, bathers, between families, people who want to go and do a swim, people who just want to jump into the lake and have a sort of plunge. There is a mesh at the bottom of it, so the river water actually just, the lake water just flows through these containers, but you are actually swimming in the lake itself, although you're sort of in a protective ring. They even go one step further, and one day in the year, they close the traffic on the river that's going through Zurich, and people can swim to work. I'm not quite sure how many of those are actually swimming to work right now. This is nothing particularly new. Obviously, there is a resurgence at the moment about wild swimming and people's connection to the waterway. So the one on the top left is a floating drawing called in Berlin. King's Cross have now got, I don't know if any of you see it, but the Artists of Ocean year or so, depending on what happens. Plus Balls in New York are endeavouring to put one on the Hudson River, and Copenhagen have got now a number of structures which enclose the harbour water, allowing you to swim in the cleaned up harbour. Again, a lot of these are doing multiple functions, really, I suppose. Maybe not the Berlin one so much, but certainly in Copenhagen and in the one in New York, what we're looking to do is actually, this is partly a regeneration. It's also about trying to re-stimulate the conversation about our rivers and our public spaces. But this is not exactly new either. This is a sketch of a floating bath that was actually moored off Charing Cross in 1875. And there used to be a number, or the idea was to have a number of these along the river. These were heated, cast iron, glazed, pools, baths. They didn't last that long, though. It took, I think, 6 hours to heat up. It's about 150,000 gallons of water. And they were also prone to rusting and disintegrating. So they didn't work too well in that respect. But there's also a long history of activity on Thames. So this is Gladys, water skiing along the Thames in the 1930s. It's a famous vintage postcard. This is taken again from the mid-30s. People swimming off the swimming in the Thames. But that all changed, should I say, really into the 1950s, or late 1950s, when the river was declared biologically dead, so, which point people weren't swimming the river at all. But there's also a sort of the connection between Londoners and the river has changed over the years. So this is a view of Somerset House back. But in the 90s, this was then the sort of building of the Basildon sewers, which after the Great Sink, changed the link with the river pretty much. What's changed it basically to what it is today. So this was in the 1900s when the embankment was built out, and this changed the effect of the river. So the river changed as well, because basically the river had been moved, pushed out, so it was now a much faster moving river, which affected obviously the safety in the river. And this is what you have today. You have the embankment outside Somerset House. But obviously, going back to Richard Rogers's 1986, what he was proposing is that the embankment in terms of the road should be buried and underground, and you could then reinstate the river shore as it used to be. Now, Londoners have always had this affinity with the Thames, in whichever way they can get it. The one on the left is the 1950s, before it was declared violent again, and then the shot in 2013, where people are still taking advantage of the low tide. So this is just outside Southbank, to have a feel like they're sitting on the sunny beach, maybe down in Brighton. But it's not as crazy as you might think in terms of Richard Rogers' proposals. This is, and I'm not going to even try and pronounce the River and Soul, but they developed over the waterway, and then in, I think it was 10-year project, they decided that they were actually going to resurface the waterway. And the statistics for this are quite amazing. I mean, they basically the stats, but it's a 7 mile long stretch of the river that they resurfaced, and it cost something, it was a huge amount of money. I'm just trying to remember the amount of money that actually was. It's a £900 million project, and initially, it had real, people didn't want it. They were just complaining, you know, it was going to be, air traffic was going to be terrible, and what was it going to sort of do? Amazingly, since that's happened, it has now become this huge public park where everyone goes to actually meet, and it's become a real meeting place and talking point in itself. I think it's amazing, it's obviously in China, so it's a different kind of political system, which maybe make these things possible, but it just shows you how you can transform in a cultural way. So back to London, we looked at when Chris came back and we started looking at, well, what could we do with the river? And there was a whole conversation about public space and developments up against the river. And so we started thinking about, there is also the super sewer which is going ahead, which will be taking apparently 90% of the effluent that potentially can go into the Thames, will now be go through the super sewer when it's built. So the idea then is that actually you potentially could swim in Thames water. At the moment the Thames is cleaner than it has been for a long time. You need to speak to fishermen who are going on the banks of the Thames. They all talk about catching freshwater shrimps, which apparently only live in well-oxygenated water. So there are certainly days when you wouldn't want to swim in the Thames, and we're not advocating swimming in the Thames as a general rule. What we're looking at is, can we encourage people to swim within an enclosure within the Thames? So what we looked at, this was our first proposal, which we submitted to the Royal Academy. So this is a series of rock pools. The pool on the left is a floating pool. As the water, as the Thames rises, because you get a 6 meter rise on the Thames, it would rise up. The top level pools would actually flood like a rock pool within the sea. And then as it falls again, those pools would stay there. And then the lower pool would kind of rise and fall with the tide. This was also then about swimming within a cleansed river water. What was important for us as well was the landscaping of this. Also trying to bring back some of the landscape that would have existed around the edges of the Thames in previous years. And it's still possible to have that if you can create environments where the currents are just slowed down. At the moment, there are moves to try and reintroduce planting along the beds of the Thames. And that's been successful if you can just stop the Thames from actually tearing it away, because it's got a horrific current at sort of peak times. So we worked with John Cook at JCLA about the types of plants that would grow on the, in the Thames, and also the sort of forest of supports to the main higher rock pool. It's almost the idea that it's similar to what you get when you throw a shopping trolley in the river, and then 2 years later it's actually been kind of sudden, it's actually kind of just got back, and it's actually got plants growing all around it, and the river is sort of taking it over as a new landscape. So these were the plans. It was a series of pools, it was a main lap pool, so you could swim looking out towards the London Eye, and a series of high levels of plunge pools. So we submitted this to the Royal Academy, we got shortlisted, and it was exhibited alongside Richard Rogers' exhibition, and we did a talk at the Royal Academy. And the feedback was amazing. It was kind of general buzz about actually this was something that people wanted now rather than in 15, 20 years' time when the super sewer has been completed. So we started to look at ways of how could this happen now. So we So we looked at doing a proposal outside Temple Steps. So this changed slightly, so this was actually then a pontoon floating in the Thames, where you were actually in water within the Thames, rather than actually floating in Thames water. The idea was that the water would get filtered, and we started to sort of develop an idea that actually, so I did your research, that actually these could, you could actually filter water of the Thames naturally, but organically, rather than these become sort of chlorinated pools floating in what we were sort of trying to avoid. At this stage, we had, as crazy as it may seem, we had the changing ribs actually on the bank, and as one person put it, you did the sort of walk of shame, and you're sort of swimming costume from the changing rooms at the top all the way down to Long Bridge to go swimming. And again, the amount of press coverage we were getting from this was just incredible. Up until this stage, Studio Octopi were funding all of this in our sort of spare time, so to speak. What we soon realised that actually, if this was going to go any further, then we had to try and raise some money. So what we did at the beginning of this year is we set up a CIC, which is a community interest company. And what that does is it try and locks in the assets of a company into the statement that you have to put with the company. So our statement was that we were going to look at how we could improve access to Britain's waterways through swimming, but also other activities. So we had a much heated debate as to what amount of money we should go for, given that the project has a construction cost of about 10 billion. So we didn't think we were going to get that. But we did raise over £140,000 in just in a month, with over 1,200 backers, almost 1,300 backers, which for us was quite amazing to think that actually people were giving us money, pledging money for this project. And suddenly it changed the whole sort of framework which we were thinking about. So during that campaign, we also submitted two other images proposals, one outside City Hall and one outside the South Bank. And these have changed dramatically in style, really. Not dramatically, but they've changed. They've tried to retain the essence that you are effectively wild swimming, and so we have these three beds which are around the pool. Sadly, it's got slightly more functional. They're taking conversations with the Port of London Authority, so we have to have this high band, 1200 high band around that you're separated from the river. But also, we've moved on to the pontoon changing rooms. There's a kiosk for selling either tourist paraphernalia or goggles and other things that would help fund it. And also then a cafe and a retail unit as well that has some public space. And I think what this is trying to merge is it's trying to sort of merge the idea of a sort of public landscape with a swimming and outdoor sort of well-being. So it isn't just about swimmers coming there anymore. It is actually about sort of broader spectrum of people. And it's also about trying to sort of reconnect with the River Thames, which is arguably London's largest public space. So currently we are using the Kickstarter funds to undertake a pre-planning report, and we're hoping by the that will be completed in the next month or so, and that we will then go forward to planning. And it's been a real challenge because we're now client, developer, and architect. So depending on which meeting we're in, depends on sort of get these different hats that we kind of have to sort of juggle. But I think it's also what's interesting about it for us and what we're sort of doing, we're working with the RSA, which is the London School of Architects, which has been set up, is talking to them about sort of the idea of how does architecture develop, where does it go in the future, and how can you as architects start to find your role more than a sort of diminishing role, which is happening a lot in terms of seeing that the sort of role of the architect diminishing. Can you take it further? Can you actually do something more with it? And we're not saying that even Kickstarter is a way to go for every project, but I think it's interesting debate about how you kind of develop